She's asking me to show everybody the kitty collar. I actually purchased I had to buy a new vehicle recently, and I wore this shirt to the theater, and it distracted every sale. They threw like 4 salespeople at me, and each one of them got distracted by the shirt, and I'm pretty sure that's why I got the best deal possible. You can get a picture of the shirt later. It's Kitty Kong, and like I still discover stuff on this shirt. Like I just found out today that the planes on here are actually being piloted by mice. one of the mice their plane got destroyed. There's a little mouse here with a parachute. Well, guess this is all I'm doing. Up against Titan Cat, you know. Do a quick introduction.
Hello.
My name is Josh Grelle. I'm a voice actor for Funimation Entertainment, Overtron 5000, ADV Films, Sentai Filmworks, a lot of other really cool places. Some of the roles you might know me as, specifically for this panel, I'm the narrator and the voice of Armin Arlert for the English dub of Attack on Titan. Some other shows you might know me from, Kenichi and Kenichi Kimani's Disciple, Akihisi Yoshi and Baka and Test, Yuki and Future Diary, Luger Kresnik in Tales of Zillia 2, Inoza in Psycho Pass. Love some Psycho Pass!
Movie is amazing!
It's gonna be awesome. Some other quotes.
Sit down now.
Devil's a part-time. There's Andy. We got a female Titan in the house. Before we get started, yes, this is a Q&A panel, but it's also a discussion, so I want you to feel completely comfortable to be able to, especially when we open up the floor to a particular question. Any question that's asked of me, that's especially of the show, I'm always happy, and I will ask you guys what you think as well, just so we can get some other opinions and perspectives and stuff in there. So this is supposed to be an interactive thing. This is not just Dance Monkey Pants. There will be a test afterwards.
Yay!
And a 30-page essay due by the end of the con Sunday.
Yeah.
You thought you were gonna come in here and just enjoy yourself, didn't you?
And you thought you were gonna come in here.
Yes. Didn't think we'd fill the room. This is pretty cool, guys.
Oh, is it?
So, Attack on Titan.
Yeah.
Really, when I first heard about this show, I had not, like, it maybe the first 3 episodes had aired, and I had not, like, I've never been much of a manga person, so, like, I've missed out on that, you know, for a while already. And when my roommate, who had watched it already and had read the manga, came up to me when he said, "Have you seen Attack on Titan?" "No, I haven't even heard of it." "You should watch it." And then she just left. When I heard about it, it's just all she had to say. So, you know, my mind immediately goes to, because I'm a space geek, I love any sort of sci-fi. So, like, to me, when I first heard it, I was like, Attack on Titan. Maybe they mean, like, Titan the Moon. Like, maybe this is supposed to be some sort of, like, Earthlings versus Jovians, or, like, versus, like, aliens from Saturn or something. We're gonna see, like, space dog fights and mech suits and stuff. This is gonna be awesome. Obviously not at all what I thought. But still, by the end of the first episode, I was still just... "Next episode, please." And then by the end of the, like, you know, I caught up, you know, but like, I went ahead and watched the first 3 or 4 episodes that had already aired by that point. Actually, that's what it was. The first 5 had aired. So I watched 1 through 5 in one sitting. So, which, of course, you know what happened to the end of 5. So that was me just going like, I don't even smoke, and I need to smoke right now. I need something to, like, just deal with these feels. And immediately I was just going to the internet, looking everything up, and just got really, really excited about the show. And then, you know, I was tuning in every week afterwards, just tuning in, getting to see what everybody else was. And really, it was one of the first shows in a very long time that I had really just got to experience as a fan. And really get to see, and just watch it and get to enjoy it and not know what was coming and not have had any sort of, like, professional spoilers or anything else like that done before. Just something that I can enjoy. And a lot of my friends also enjoyed. And then to just see how it became... bigger and bigger and bigger as it reached more and more people all across the world. It was just insane. And then
we couldn't be on time to audition.
And like when we actually found out, we knew that Funimation had it. You know that. And I live in Dallas, Texas, where Funimation is located. I've been working with them for about 5 or 6 years. So in the back of my head, this entire time, I'm thinking, oh my God, we're gonna dub this. We're gonna dub this. I wonder if I get to audition.
I really want to audition.
God, I hope I get to audition. And just sitting there picking out characters and stuff, and lo and behold, I really start gravitating toward the character of Armin, especially around episode 9, when you really get to see his character turn, especially with the big speech, and when you see this big realization, this internal realization from him that he's not useless, that he's not a burden, not to his friends and not to anybody else. And you see that change, and I'm like, wow, I've felt those things before. I really like this character. He's a lot like me. I want to audition for him. And I got to. And I got the part. That doesn't happen. Like, that's crazy. That's like, I can't even come up with an analogy for what that is, other than just a miracle, really. For me, it was just this pinch me. It's like, I still feel like someone should be waking right now for a really awesome dream, and it's just been this really wild ride. And now I get to go to cons all the time and see people dressed up like giant naked dudes.
Yes!
Life goal achieved! So, yeah, and also that's the other cool thing is, like, one of the big things that I've noticed in fandoms ever since I really got to start going to conventions a lot, and I mean, I've been an anime fan since I was like 6 or 7 years old, but the actual, like, the full scale of the anime world was really foreign to me. Like, was not anything that I really knew about until I got out of high school and got to go to my first convention, which was Oda. Has anybody ever been to Otakon before in the States?
No.
Okay, so a couple people got you. Okay. Well, that was my first con, and it's one of the bigger ones that we have in the States. If you ever go there, please don't wear your costume outside, because Baltimore in August is considered a tropic, like subtropical in terms of temperature. There's people that are out there in line sometimes for 3 hours for pre-reg in these full-on costumes, and it's 108 degrees outside with like 80 to 90% humidity. It feels like you're in a dog's mouth. To be honest with you, so please don't do that. But it's a great show if you're ready to go. And when I went, that's when, you know, the world of anime really started to open up to me. And one of the cool things I've noticed is that some of the shows that really seem to make the biggest impact on a lot of people are ones that include uniforms. Like, has anybody noticed this? Like, and like, you get Free, the Iwo Jima swim club. People, like, it's a couple.
Not only is it just sexy, yeah.
But aside from that, I mean, you have the jackets, you have the swim club jackets, and you know, you people that identify with these different teams, they get to do that. Or on High School Post Club, you get the Hantalia, you have the uniform. It's all these different things that have to do with uniforms, and the fact that you have a way to visually show that you belong to this particular fandom, or that you like this particular fandom. I think that's one thing that a lot of people gravitate to, and Titan is by far the biggest one that I've seen so far. Like, to go to conventions and see groups of hundreds, if not a couple of thousand, it's, to me, the Titan fandom, especially the Titan cosplay community, has almost become like the anime community's version of the 501st. The Star Wars group that does this amazing Stormtrooper and Jedis and Sith and sometimes droids and all these other things. It's just this huge, huge group. And getting to go to these cons, and it really felt cool to go to cons, and even though there were 501st members there, the Titan people outnumbered them. What you got now, Empire? Tell you what you don't have. You don't have these cool blades. You don't have OBM gear.
You have laser guns.
You have laser guns, but they can't
hit
anything. anybody seen that meme where a stormtrooper in a red shirt from Star Trek into a firefight, the stormtrooper misses every shot, and the red shirt dies anyway? So, I know, I'm getting off track. That will happen a lot. I'm just telling you right now. So if you start to get bored, please just raise your hand and be like, Titan! Question about Titan! So, speaking of, do we have any? Yes.
It's kind of more of a comment.
Okay, comment's good.
Your story about how you got introduced to Attack on Titan is tame in comparison to mine.
Okay.
My friend Noah came over and said, I want to show you this adorable show.
This adorable show? Yes. Take a look at this slice of life.
It's really cute. Look at all these cute characters and they're dreaming and oh!
Have seen an anime, like for me, Titan was one of the first animes that I've seen in a long time that actually made me feel like real living terror as I was watching this show. Does anybody else feel that? Like, was that kind of like a first for you watching that show too? Like, it's
actually gonna happen.
I don't know, maybe it's just the idea of being eaten. Maybe it's the idea of being eaten by a giant naked human. Like, I was just sitting here thinking, this is what a chicken wing feels like all the time. It really starts to put stuff in perspective, especially the idea of we're all living in a cage. We're all, at this point, we've domesticated ourselves to protect ourselves from this outside force, but we've essentially made ourselves livestock. We've essentially made ourselves just a snack for them to eventually get to. And I'm sitting here, going like, this is what chickens in a coop feel like. I just got to feel horrible, especially with those. Can you imagine, like, how many times have you you eaten chicken and had this fantastical smile on your face? Chicken just like, that's what they feel like! That's what we're doing! So, like, this show is gonna make me go vegan. For real, like, life lessons. But, yeah.
It is very well depicted.
Yeah.
The violence, that's why it was so scary. Mm-hmm.
That was
fun.
That's dramatic rescue. Thank you, Aaron.
I stopped watching, and then I saw the preview, and that was in the preview, and I was like, oh my god, I have to keep watching it.
Yeah, seriously. Just so many. It's all the cliffhangers, too. Yes.
It's actually kind of funny. The first time I saw it, at my high school, there was an anime club, and we'd watch the first three episodes of new animes all the time, and the teacher picked Attack on Titan. So we're sitting in the middle of a high school, and we're like, oh, this is kind of interesting, and then all of a sudden people are being eaten, and we're like, are we supposed to be watching this?
At least you watch it
on, like, the big smart board, so it's not like you can just look away.
It's like
a giant screen in the middle of a classroom with all the lights off in the middle of our school during lunchtime. So then we have to go to our next class, and we're like, I don't really want to be enclosed in anything.
Yes. At least you got to Sasha's part.
I know this is just sudden, but can we have algebra outside today?
Can we not?
Because
I'm
nothing. Can we just not be inside right now?
Yeah, seriously.
And my teacher's like sitting behind his desk and he's like, oh, I probably should have previewed this before I showed it.
Probably. He's like an idea teach.
The worst part was that I had looked away because I was doing homework. And I look over. One of my club members was like, oh my god, and I look over and there's people being eaten. I'm like, what did I miss?
Yeah.
Oh, no,
are we watching a different show?
Like, 1 second they're looking at like butterflies in a field and then people are being eaten. I'm like, I'm never doing homework again.
Another thing, you know, talking about how it's portrayed, another thing that makes it so terrifying is the fact that, you know, you see a lot of animes where they'll have these horrific monsters, they'll have these giant, you know, creatures or whatever, but usually either the main character, someone associated with the main character, or some sort of force, outside force, can deal with it usually somewhat easily. Or someone has some sort of super mega awesome power from the get-go, and it's just like, Titans, whatever. See that? And make his head explode.
And then Aaron died.
Yeah, but see, then you see a show like this, where even the heroes are powerless. They are helpless.
Yeah.
It makes you feel like the person, you know, just watching it, you feel 10 times that amount of helplessness. And
anybody can die at any time.
That's right.
No one is safe.
Thanks for that. Now I'm
apparently Armin, because he's narrating.
Yeah.
Like, it's like, you can't narrate unless you're kind of thinking back on it, I think. Like, I'm like, and that's the other thing, like, when is Armin narrating this? When is he recalling this? Is this a few years down the road? Is this several years down the road? Or is this just a couple of weeks? Like, is this just, what's going on here?
Day by day.
Yeah, it could be, you never know.
It's like diary.
Exactly. Like, I've always wondered if it's supposed to be just kind of like a diary thing. Like, maybe he's recounting all these things because someone should know down the road. Because he's the only person in the beginning of the show who's all about books. Yeah. It's like, look, I know this is illegal. We're not supposed to be looking at this because it's knowledge. Yeah, exactly. But we're going to look at it anyway. And I wonder if maybe that could be, like, I've thought about what if maybe that's what he's doing, I'm wondering if everyone is dead. And he's just recounting all this so that future generations know, don't make the same mistake we did.
And don't get eaten.
Yeah, and don't get eaten. This is kind of rule one in the world of Titan, yeah. Don't get
eaten. Unless you're like Armin and almost got
so cold. So yeah, double tap.
I think part of the shock factor for me who was Attack on Titan, because you go into an anime and you have like this mentality where like the main people and their like closest friends don't die. They just
doesn't happen.
You might lose one, but then it's a big turning point and the main character gets ridiculously stronger in response.
Right.
Whereas like,
because I have
friends. Like a few episodes in and Armin gets swallowed and Aaron's arm is, then I'm like, what is going on?
Yeah.
Like, to me, the prime example of like what you're talking about, like what we usually expect, like some, like unless it's a straight up horror anime, like Another or Future Diary, or so like a survival horror type thing, where you're expecting people to die at some point anyway, and even if they're main characters. But then you think of shows like Gurren Lagann, Evangelion. Or any of the Blue Exorcist, or any of the old, like almost all of the old school mech shows that were about like the young hero, you know, growing up and going through all these pains. He always has the initial character, the one that is showing him the ropes or is showing her the ropes, eventually loses it or gets ousted or something. To an extent, you kind of expect that because that's what is required for the character to grow, for the main character to actually have an arc. But in this, it's just like, anybody can go, we have no idea. Yes.
Okay, I'm gonna be that person.
Okay, be that person.
Yeah.
Be proud of it. Who do I ship with Armin? Who'd you ask? Like, Sean, between Sean and Aaron, which one would I ship with Armin?
Marco!
Yeah,
John. Yeah, John. I don't know.
Marco's in a box.
I mean, Armin Aaron's kind of the immediate go-to just in my head, just because it's like, oh, it makes sense, and that, that's what shipping's all about. But I thought Armin Amy would be fun. I thought Armin Krista, but you see, I'm keeping the blondes together. Everyone loves Krista, which makes me think she's the main villain in this whole thing. I think Krista's the mastermind behind all of this. Just wait. And it's the quiet ones you have to watch out for. It's still my favorite. I love it. Especially the other thing, because you can tell. Everyone trusts her. She brings people horses, for God's sake. Yeah, okay. And, right over here, use the name with the purple. You, yes.
How was it to work with the voice actors for Armin, Aaron, and Misaka?
It was, do you mean like in the booth?
Yeah.
Well, we actually don't record at the same time. We actually do it one person at a time. We usually would record. Like, that's kind of the process that it's kind of been the go-for for any sort of dubbing work in the anime industry for a very long time. Is it's generally a logistics nightmare to try and schedule even two or three actors to come in at once. It's not unlike herding cats. Because it costs so much in terms of studio time and in terms of just to record, and it takes far longer to try and record three people at once and make sure that all of their takes are gonna be fine and ready to move on to the next stuff, as opposed to just one person at a time where you can just focus on that. So, like, in a way, you do get to work with them if they've recorded before you. And there were many times where Aaron and Mikasa, where both Bryce and Trina had recorded before me. I believe the episode 9, the scene where Armin has his big speech, all the stuff leading up to that, they had already voiced. So I got to play off that, and it, as an actor, it really does help to have other people already record it, because then you have them to be able to play off of, to be able to just react emotionally, as opposed to trying to think about, okay, he's probably going to say the line like this, Trina's going to say the line like this, this is the operative word of their line, therefore I have to hit this word in order for this read to make any sense. And that also comes down to the director. That's their job, is overall to, you know, make sure that everybody's going to sound the same, and they have to have all that in their head before we even start recording. So, I mean, it's like you have to kind of be a little insane to work in this industry, I think, or in any sort of creative industry. Yay, crazy. But yeah, it was really, really fun. You may have
before I ask this question, I have something to give you.
What? Oh. A gift? Is that Kinoza?
Yes.
It's totally Kinoza. That's awesome. Holy crap, did you make this?
I had
permission. Awesome, very good. Keep calm and attack on Titan. Thank you. This is awesome. Oh, it's Mitri and Armin on his shoulders. Oh, and you got Subaru, too.
Yeah.
Awesome. Little Mitri with his shark thing. Answer your question.
You have to do a lot of, like, screaming.
Yeah, Armin screams a lot.
She makes it so beautiful.
How many, like, breaks did you have to take from that?
There was actually only one episode where we were just like, okay, we need to take a break, or we need to stop if I'm going to be able to continue. And thankfully, we were at the end of my session that day when I actually recorded his big scream in F5. The one that hit Tumblr like a storm. Did anybody see... to see the Tumblr stuff that happened with the Armin screen, after it had gotten leaked before it even hit Toonami, for those who didn't, Tumblr is a magical place. Someone in the States, do you guys get stuff from Write Stuff? Does Write Stuff deliver up here?
Yeah.
Oh, awesome, good. Like, Write Stuff is so good. Write Stuff is, especially in the States, is notorious for, if you pre-order something, they would usually send it, sometimes, as little as a week and as much as a month before it's actually supposed to street.
Wow.
And so there are people that got their entire collector's edition copies of the first 13 episodes before we had even gotten to airing episode 5. And they just got it. And so, of course, you know, some people, like they do, put everything on YouTube. And so people were just trying to get it as fast as they could. Somebody got the scream from F5 and went on Tumblr.
Yes.
But it was just the scream. No visuals. Just the scream. And so you just hear this completely out of context. There was no lead up. There was none of the stuff there was none of the dramatic part of him breaking down, watching all of his friends die, and then all of a sudden Jerry Garcia Titan is just like, hey, come here. Or Santa Claus Titan, if you will. None of that lead up, no visual, nothing. It was just Aaron, no! Scream! And someone comments, of course, because it's Tumblr, it's just like, he sounds like Aaron threw a spider at him. And within like half an hour, someone had drawn an actual animated GIF of Armin sitting there with Aaron with the greatest little like smile on his face, just going, just throwing the spider at him, and just and all this stuff going on, and it's ridiculous. Well, then, and I still haven't figured out who this was, some friends of mine that I went to high school with apparently go to Tumblr, found that, and was like, oh my god, we're crying, this is hysterical, we went to school with him, the last time that we heard him scream like this was when we pushed him down a hill in a shopping cart. To which, now there are several Tumblrs and some of those MMD animated things of Aaron just pushing on the shopping cart. And here's the thing, I can't deny it because it's a true story.
Please tell me
that's what what you do in small town Texas in the summer when there's nothing else to do. You film your own Jackass stunts. To great effect. And then eventually they come and bite you in the butt on the internet after 11 years. What were we talking about before that? Say it again. Yes, Titan. Yes, that's what we're here for. Yes, in the streaming. And so, yeah, thankfully. And I have been asked many times to do the stream at conventions, and sometimes I will. It kind of depends on how I'm doing. If it's the first day, usually I won't, so I'll just put that out there right now. I would like to be able to talk to all of you for the rest of the weekend, as opposed to not. So please, I won't do the speech. I will do the speech, though, if someone wants to hear that.
Yes.
Now? All right. Got to get in character. And anybody else that's got Titan uniform on, you feel free to stand up and salute with me. Alright, let's go. I am a soldier, and I have dedicated my heart to the restoration of humanity, sir! Nothing could make me prouder than dying for such a noble cause. If we use the Titan ability that he has, and the rest of the manpower we have left, I believe we can do it! We can retake this city! For humanity's glory, and what little time I have left to live, I will advocate his strategic value! That was the scene when I saw it aired, I just went, especially, I salute so hard I cracked a rib. I'm just like, I want to play him! And I got it! you know what? That actually didn't feel that bad. I might be able to do the scream.
Oh my god!
We'll see!
Another question. Over here. Yes, you in the uniform. Yes.
They broke through the wall.
Can you imagine if it was just a love tap from the colossal Titan? Oh, okay. Well, you just kind of creep so good.
Hey guys, can I join your parties?
Hey, what's going on, guys? Was just at a convention last weekend, and she cosplayed a sailor scout.
Oh, yeah!
Like, Sailor Moon in a scout uniform, and instead of blades, it was just, it was her wand. Yeah, just several versions of the wand. That one didn't work. Let's get another one over here. You should be back to Urban.
Alright, episode 9, just before the big speech.
Yes.
Armin has this kind of epiphany that Aaron Mikasa
yes.
didn't ever really think of him as the coward.
Mm-hmm.
Now, going forward, would that change the way you approach his character?
Absolutely. Like, his mentality changes pretty drastically at that point, at least to me. Because after that point, he ceases to think of himself as a burden, he ceases to think of himself as a coward and a loser. The only place where he still shows any sort of humility is when he's coming up with strategies and when he's coming up with plans. Case in point, when he's talking to Pixis for the first time, going over his idea to plug up the wall. Even after he just comes up with this plan off the top of his head. He's like, well, this is what we got. I think we can do this. And after he lays it out, he still says, still, I'm fully prepared to admit that this is a horrible plan, and if you guys have something else, please, by all means, use it. And he has that humility, but it doesn't come from a place of self-doubt anymore. It's to me, in that moment, that's more of reminiscent. That's more of a representation of just kind of the Japanese way of always be like, you're superior, obviously I'm wrong. Like, this is just an idea, take it as you will. You're the decision maker, you're the decider. Nobody got that joke. Awesome. I was making a George W. Bush joke. Nobody got it. But then again, you're not even gonna care about George W. Bush. What am I thinking? That particular moment, though, is you know, like you pointed out, that is the most important moment for Armin in that entire in this first season, because up until that point, like you said, it's been nothing but self-loathing and doubt. He sees himself as a burden. He sees himself as unequal to the people around him, and that he must do everything that he can in order to get out of that. But the problem with thinking like that is, if you're the one thinking it, you're never going to be satisfied with how good you're doing. Like, it's completely dependent on what other people are saying. He needed to hear that from his friends. And in that moment, and you see it too, and it's my favorite moment in that series, especially that episode in particular, just because of the visual poetry that is going on behind him as he comes to that realization, as he finally, you know, says it out loud, you know, in his head, that I convinced myself that I was a burden to all of you, that I was a poor excuse for a friend. I've been my own worst enemy this entire time. And as those doubts and everything else kind of crumble away inside of him, the Titan corpse crumbles away behind it, like, with him, like, with those fears and doubts. And it's one of the most beautiful, poetic, visual moments in that show to me. And again, made me fall in love with the character and even more solidified my love of the show. But after that point, that's pretty much it. He's good to go. I really, like, and I have a theory, though. And here's my theory of where his next arc is going to go, and I'm sure that they might have covered stuff in the manga, but don't tell me! I really think that he's going to take over Erwin's position. I think that that's kind of where Armin's future lies, is just because he's such a, you know, a brilliant strategist, and because the only thing that he has not gone through that would give him the experience required to take over Aaron Schmidt's job is the fact that he has not been in a position yet where he had to make a plan that required someone to die. Like, his plans are just like, yes, people can die in this, and they probably will, but his plans never hinge on people actually dying, or someone or many people actually dying. And I think it's going to have to come to a point like that, where he's put in a position where he has to put someone he really cares about, pretty much sacrifice them if a plan is going to work. And I think that is what we're gonna have to see in order for him to reach that point. But I could be wrong. The manga may have already covered it. There's still room for it. Okay, so they've kind of covered some of it in some form or fashion.
Okay, cool.
I'll see next year when season 2 comes out, finally! Did you guys see, like, the official announcement that they said, yes, it is, like, they were totally, they are going to start producing it 2016. It will be done, which to me says, usually, from what I've experienced in terms of how fast Japanese can put something out once they start production, I'm pretty sure we'll see it probably late summer, early fall of next year. Woo. That's my thing. So, 2016! You sir, you're getting far back.
One thing about the show I'm curious about.
Okay.
Why is this the only show where all the summers are solving or something German?
You got me. I have no idea. Well, all I know about is just, like, Japan and Germany have, you know, ever since World War II, you know, they still have a fairly good relationship in terms of, you know, their politics and in terms of just their, you know, what's up?
It's because it takes place in Europe, am I right?
Yeah, I mean, I would imagine because, you know, the show itself is supposed to be set in Europe, but we don't know it's in Europe. We just know there's a lot of blondes.
A lot of people have very dramatic names, so a lot of people theorize that it takes place kind of in the Germany area.
Right, like to me it always seemed like it's not necessarily supposed to be Germany or supposed to be Europe, because in its own way, it's just kind of its own world. It's there, like it has the architecture, it has like the feel of it, and the names obviously too, Jaeger, with German, like very German. You have Christoph, Schmidt, Jean Kirstein. You have all of these, and Connie Springer. All of these names that are German based. Aaron's first name, the way that they spell it, is actually Turkish in origin. But I mean, you have all these things, and like whether or not that actually is supposed to be evidence that the story itself is taking place in Germany or in like some sort of European country is anybody's guess. But I have no answer for you in terms of the music. I just know Linked Horizon makes really good songs. Okay, first or second theme?
I love the second one.
Just because, like, when you really pay attention to the lyrics.
The lyrics are amazing.
Yeah, the lyrics of the second opening, which it's basically the theme of the Scouts.
Yeah.
It's them saying, we know we're gonna die. We know that this is going to be a horrible death, but
bye
we're
guys.
Going to it anyway, by God. And it's, and, you know. So, like the way, when you really just start to think of, like, wow, this is the world they live in. Like, they had to make a theme about them dying in order to make themselves feel somewhat better about the fact that they're going to a horrible death. It's really dark and gritty. But yeah, I mean, it's hard to beat just the sheer epicness and getting your blood pumping of the first theme. Yeah, the visuals for the second one are really intense too, especially Armin being drenched in blood.
Yeah,
like, when does that happen?
And he looks so angry.
I know, he does. He's just kind of like, where's the next one? You know, because he becomes Batman, obviously.
Yeah.
Yes?
Have you seen the abridged
version? You have. You sound like a majestic eagle! I've seen bits and pieces, that one in particular.
Can you do your best Armin impression from that?
Do my impression of their Armin?
Yeah.
Just like, I don't think I can! Let me get this straight. That Titan, beating up all those other Titans, is Aaron. What a asshole! Trying to kill these things, and he's just kicking them around and eating them.
It's pretty fun.
Team Four Star is usually pretty brilliant in everything they do.
Yeah.
Has Team Four Star ever come to a convention up here or to Edmonton? If you ever have a chance to bring them up, like if they ever come up here, hang out with those guys. They are some of the coolest fans like you'll ever meet. Just really, really cool dudes. Say it one more time. Of any of their abridged series?
That's tough.
Dragon Ball. Just.
I like Vegeta and Nappa.
Just for Vegeta alone.
Vegeta
in that is amazing. And Goku, you know, they make Goku so charmingly stupid. Like, I love that. But yeah, everything that they do with those things, they have so much fun. Now,
yeah,
Vegeta, it's a Pokemon! You have to weaken it first, Nappa. You self-destruct. I hate when they do that. Vegeta. I'll go off on tangents again, sorry. Yes.
I know with me when I was watching Attack on Titan, how much did it boil your blood when you found out that the other Titan shifters that ruined the sanctuary that they lived in,
mm-hmm.
opened up everything? Like,
with
Annie killing Petra,
mm-hmm.
like,
that
destroys
me
now.
Like,
how did that make
I bet that tree was petrified.
Oh my god! Yeah. I'm gonna get that.
How long did it take? A while.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh my god.
all those guys. Just female titan just swatting people down. That's the closest Armin ever came to holding hands with a girl. Female titan.
Did I just get lucky?
Yes, ma'am. Actually, hang on. We have. I need to get back over here. You, sir, and then you, and then you. Yes. Do you ever work in LA? Is that what you asked? Oh, how did I end up doing work in LA? Like the video game work. Actually, the voice of Sadie's. The voice of Sadie, the drill sergeant, Patrick Sykes. He does so much stuff other than just voice work. I mean, like, he's in Attack on Titan, but you can hear him, like, he's in One Piece, he's in World of Warcraft, he's in Butler, he's in Italia. I mean, the guy who, actually, here you go. Another voice you would probably definitely know him from. He's Germany in Italia. The guy who played, thank you. But he does a lot of writing work. He also does a lot of voice directing work out in LA, and a lot of times he'll do it for video game work. And he'll throw auditions to a lot of the Dallas actors, and that's how I got 2 out of 3 video games that I worked on out in LA was because he tossed me an audition.
If I remember correctly, Patrick Sykes is also the person who helped get Bryce into getting Aaron.
Really?
Yeah. Who?
Yes, actually, yeah, you're completely right. I'm pretty sure you're right on that. Like, because Patrick was the guy who actually got tossed them a lot of names of people in LA that they could use. I think he's the person that that got Bryce and Mercer and Lauren Landa their auditions for their respective parts. Sim, what's up?
Great. Have you seen the Levi OVA?
No, I have not seen the Levi OVA.
Okay.
If I'm wrong, it's based on its own, like, because I know there's a manga series that kind of focuses on Levi's backstory. You're sitting here shaking your head, you're like, do you not like the OVA? You don't like the OVA? Okay. Does he not do any cleaning in the OVA? Do what? Oh, is that all he does? Is that all the OVA is?
No.
Says, I'm gonna clean this town?
No, the OVA is pain in tears.
Gotcha. Just OVA wasn't all that great for some people. Just
maybe. You'll feel heavy.
Yeah, I'm sure. I mean, there's always heavy feels in Titan. I mean, Mikasa's backstory.
Yes.
Oh my! Let the tears flow. It's so hardcore too. Like, that's one way to get a hardcore life lesson, isn't it?
Yeah.
Jeez.
Did
you have a question?
Well, I was gonna say about the feels about the whole thing.
Right. Yeah.
We got into it when she was 3, just the anime and stuff like that.
Uh huh.
But when I got it for a gift. Mm-hmm. She went downstairs to watch it, and about 2 hours later, she comes upstairs crying, face huge, puffy eyes, because it's like, what did I buy you to watch? Like, you're crying, you're having a nervous breakdown. So she finally made me sit down one day, one night. We watched the whole thing, one sitting.
Wow.
So, needless to say,
you're the cool
it's Attack on Titan is great. I love it, but man.
You're
Matt.
A cool mom.
Yeah, that's really all you can say for it. It's a rough ride. It can be a very rough ride. And I mean, it's still, I mean, to have to look at life and existence that way is like her line. This is a cruel world. It's also a beautiful world. And it really is just about what you do with it and how you perceive it.
Because when they go out to go to their death to do the Titan thing. Mm. It's beautiful out there. And like when Aaron and Armin were sitting there reading the book when they were watching the Titans go, right? It's like they want to go out. They want to experience it.
Stop,
like
you're
said.
Hurting me.
That's the other thing too, is like just thinking about Armin's parents having left, trying to, they wanted to see this world. They wanted to, you know, see everything that, you know, was out there.
Manga elaborates on that.
Manga, I'm sure it does. I'm hoping that it did. Because I'm kind of wondering, Say it, like, slightly does.
Maybe you should just read it.
I like guessing. It's the same thing with Game of Thrones and me. And I like going, oh, maybe this person's gonna do that. Maybe they're gonna do this way in order to make that happen. And just all this stuff, but it's because I'm a writer and acting and stuff. Yes.
Uh-huh. And so people are saying it might be him that's dead.
Going off the anime alone, you could
say there's a 50-50 chance. Uh-huh. That's so good. You need to leave. You need some sunglasses. I actually, that was one thing about the manga that I had heard about, but just because of potential spoilers, I won't talk about it here. But yeah, I have had my suspicions about whether or not that actually was Marco. And
I'm not too sure.
But on the back of like the manga books, it has like the 10 cadets, like the top 10.
Yeah.
And when somebody dies out of that, they take it out. So
but
he's
Marco's
not there anymore.
Right. But Marco not there anymore?
He's not on the back anymore.
Okay, gotcha.
Well, so. Then again,
it could be part of the surprise back. If you put him in the picture, they're going to figure it out.
Does anybody have a question that is not asked for me?
Sorry.
No, that's not very good. I just wanted to, I always wanted to make sure that people have a chance. Yes. The weirdest line in the show? Armin didn't really have any weird lines that I can think of. I can think of the weirdest Titan that I saw. The show-stopping Titan. Second runner-up Titan would be the episode where, you know, they're trying to, after they've had their first scout mission outside the wall and they're trying to get back inside, is the one Titan that comes over the hill is just like, what's that? Yeah. Raise the roof, guys! This is gonna be great!
And it's like, hey girl, you're sexy!
It's gonna be real hard to grab people with my hands. That's like, it's gonna make it work. Spider Titan.
Yeah, yeah.
That's creepy pasta.
Yeah.
Somebody work on that.
No, that's.
Sorry. What was your question?
Okay, so I'm gonna have to pull up my camera for this one.
Okay.
Question: have you been to OMG Con? Because my friend went there.
Yes, I've been to OMG several times.
And she sent me, posted a video on Facebook of. Sorry, I need to get my. Are you doing the Mikasa scream? Can you do it for me on video?
The Mikasa scream?
Are you like Mikasa?
Oh, Mikasa. Huh.
Ready?
Yeah. And so you're talking about young Armin, like kid Armin. Oh god. Alright. And I'll see if I can get there today.
Armin Arlert! Armin Arlert! Mikasa!
There you go.
I'd rather take a few lumps and brawl like a beast.
Yeah, that's
kid Armin.
Little Armin. Okay, has anybody else seen the trailer that they actually animated it? They animated the Titan Junior High?
Yes! Yes.
Animated the Titan Junior High that's going to start airing, I think, this year. So, like, I think it's going to be like 12, 13 episodes. And, like, it's just... Everybody's little chibi forms and everything. They're going to school. It's gonna be crazy fun. Yes.
How did you initially come up with a voice for Armin, and what kind of warm-ups do you do to get
him? Warm-ups. Usually it's just belting out whatever songs that I feel like singing on the way to the studio. I mean, there's certain warm-ups that I do, and they're. It takes like half an hour to do, and it's just going through the alphabet with different vowel sounds, and I have to do it like 5-6 times, and just to get it warmed up. But for the most part, it was a joint, like coming up with Armin's voice was a joint thing between Mike McFarland and myself. Mike McFarland, he plays John Kirstein, he was also the voice director. He really wanted to make sure that frailty and that kind of fear and that self-doubt was always present in Armin's voice, which is so.
With Armin, everything really had that kind of airy quality, that almost kind of breathy thing. Like, he's always got this breath behind him that just kind of gives him this really frail sound. But after episode 9, that starts to diminish.
Like that, it's kind of a subtle thing that we did, but if you listen really carefully, after episode 9, episode by episode, Armin's voice becomes a little more confident, a little less doubt, a little less fear. And like, you know, until he's in like life-threatening situations and stuff, but I mean, even then, like, one of the first times you really see him just being like, God, man, Armin's dropped lately, is when the female Titan is sitting there about to, you know, kill his friends, and he just shouts and then tries to distract her and just really kind of puts himself on the line again there. He really does a lot of brave things, and like in that moment again, that was another big stepping point for him, where his voice very slightly changes afterwards. There's a little less frailty, there's more confidence and all that. So I'm really hoping that we get to see him at some point just being badass. Yeah.
Oh, just since I'm always passing me, but I want to bring it to Tabata as well.
Okay.
Did you always, do Nitori and Armin to you have similarities? And did you draw from Armin to Nitori recently?
Nitori?
Yeah.
Actually, yeah, to do Nitori, I did draw a lot from Armin in terms of his voice. Nitori is so cute. he's a very similar character. He wants to try very hard. He's always working to improve himself. And I really enjoyed, and like, I'm not gonna say any spoilers for those who haven't seen Freak season 2, but I really enjoyed where he ended up at the end of that season, and I'm really looking forward to seeing what they're gonna do with that. Like, how is he going to be when he has that responsibility? And I think that that's gonna be like, that's when you'll really see him start to shine. Yeah, he may not be the greatest swimmer, but he's great at motivating people.
Yeah.
And mm-hmm. We'll see.
Can you do a snippet?
Oh, can I do a little knee turn?
Yeah.
Seriously, Rain, your swimming is amazing. You're like some sort of water wizard.
Water wizard.
Let's see. Yes, in the back. Do I have a favorite voice to do?
Villains.
Yeah.
I love villains.
Any sort of villain, especially those grandiose, very pompous villains that... has anyone seen Blood Blockade Battlefront this season? Gotcha. The character, Fent. He's the first villain that you really kind of see in the show. He's just major... He's essentially kind of the Joker of that world, and I was just pretty much like, all right, I'm gonna Mark Hamill this, and just kind of did my Mark Hamill, and, like, just my kind of version of the Joker for him, and, you know, added my own style to it, but just having, especially because he's so insane, like, the very first time you see him, it's just him broadcasting in mass this giant, message to the city about how his new plan to destroy them is coming to fruition, and it's just surprise, surprise! Hello, it's been a while. Don't tell me you forgot the most diabolical genius of El Salem's lot. It's me, Fent, the king of depravity. Just to go crazy with these guys, like, I love that guy. Any sort of villain, 10, cool, thank you, 10. Any sort of villains, usually, just because you get to be larger than life when you get to play villains like that. A lot of time, I've gotten to play a lot of really awesome heroes and stuff over the years, but before I ever really started getting a lot of these like hero roles, these big lead roles in shows, my bread and butter was always villains, and it was the dream come true. It was like I got to go in and be a different psychopath every day. Another question? Yes, sir. And then can you hold that thought?
Yes.
Actually, just 1 second. You, sir. Yes.
Since you like villains so much, who is your favorite Game of Thrones villain?
Well, there's only a few that I can actually call straight up villains. Like, to me, some people thought that the spider was a villain. I kind of thought from the get-go that, no, he's got something else going on. And to me, he was my favorite character just kind of from the get-go. Yes, he does things that could label him a villain, but he has the kingdom's best interest at heart at all times, is the way he seems to me. He, yes, whatever his whatever his motives, whatever his plans, someone could get hurt, someone's probably going to die in the process of it, but he does not do it for himself. He does not do it for personal gain. He does it because he believes that he is leading this kingdom towards a brighter future. And you can call that a villain. Like that's the thing about villains, is most often villains don't ever see themselves as a villain.
Right.
They see themselves as doing good. They see themselves as their own hero, or hero for other people. But if you want to get, you want to talk just straight up villain, Cersei.
Oh my god.
Okay, who all has been watching Game of Thrones since, you know, caught up with the latest season?
Shame.
Yeah, okay. Shame, is that what you said?
Shame, yeah, there you go.
Yes, shame! Shame! I would break down if that was happening to me. And she... and yes, you sir, you had a question.
So, when you go from, like, say, like, character like Tarmin or Frail, and then you'll play a character like Inaza, after you're done the move, is there, like, different, like, you live with that day? And is there ever a time where you're like, you guys move, and you're like, I need to go watch Sailor Moon or something?
Yeah. I need to go watch My Little Pony right now. Boy, Pinkie Pie, take me away. Like, oh yeah, there's definitely plenty of times. Like, I mean, sometimes, actually, recording on Blood Sea. Recording on the Blood Sea series, I didn't have a character in that show. It was just bit parts. I played about 20 to 30 people dying in horrific ways that made some of the Titan deaths look tame. And I was just, I need to go shut my brain off right now.
Can someone please throw like rainbows and sunshine at me right now, please?
So yeah, I mean, there's definitely plenty of times where characters, I mean, a lot of times you have to put yourself into these very, like for Armin, for the first half of the season, I had to kind of put myself into this mindset of, you're a burden, you're worthless, you're, you know, nobody thinks, I mean, like, just, like, you have to, like, it's because sometimes to get those, like, because that's what he's thinking, and if you want to, like, sometimes you have to feel those things to be able to really portray them, and it's hard, it's really hard, but, like, sometimes, when you're done with that, you just need to deflate. You have to find some way to disconnect from all of it, and sometimes you just want to not feel anything after that. You just want to sit there and turn your brain off and be entertained. Just do something. But so, yeah, I mean, yeah, there's definitely plenty of shows, and a lot of actors that have those. And, I mean, I'm trying to think of an example. I mean, think of, I know it's been a few years since then, but think of, his name escapes me, he was a Joker, Dark Knight. Thank you, yeah. Like, talking about how going into the mindset of being that type of person, you know, that being the Joker really kind of drove him to some very dark places. And it's anybody's guess whether or not that's the reason that, you know, if that is what drove him to, you know, do those drugs and overdose or anything like that. But a lot of actors face that. I mean, look at Robin Williams, so then look at really any actor, a lot of, in any creative mind, I think, anybody who makes their living or just expresses themselves through any sort of personal creativity where they're really drawing on their life experiences, their past experiences, their thoughts, there's a lot of suffering, and it can be hard. It can be very hard for a lot of people. Yes, ma'am.
Do I know the He-Man meme? Is that what you said?
Yeah. Oh, the, that thing is actually talking about?
He-Man and Armin are the same person.
He-Man and Armin are the same dude. Like, I'm pretty sure, like, I love the idea that, you know, if Armin, I love the memes that people made. It was like, I want to be useful too. And then he turned into like a giant He-Man, just like, dang it.
I don't know. I don't know all the lyrics, unfortunately, so I'm sorry.
Can you just sing the chorus?
Just
sing
it. Yeah. What's going on? Oh, I have to do an Armin's voice and see if I can get, Armin. And I say, hey, yeah. Hey, yeah. I say, hi.
that Armin would ever be a good singer?
Probably not. Not if I'm voicing him. Yes, sir.
So, you were talking about the evolution of Armin, mm-hmm. and voice, etc. You said you also did Newt from
Future Diary, yeah.
Who I really like his art for that show. Mm-hmm.
It's pretty rough.
Yeah.
He's really not a likable character for pretty much the first half, if not more, of that show. Not only that, he uses people. Like, this dude straight up uses people, and he knows that they could die, or that they're going to die, and he doesn't care. Yes, he's scared, yes, he's frightened, and, you know, who's to say that any one of us wouldn't do something very similar if put in the same situation as him, especially if you're a 14-year-old.
Yeah.
Like, that's a rough situation to be in. But, yeah, he's just, there's a lot of moral things with Yuki that really, really were tough to deal with.
Yeah. So what was it like voicing that character going through that evolution through the arc? Because near the end you see this big change where it goes from being that frail character that uses, mm-hmm. where he's standing with Yuno, getting people down and knocking.
Right, yeah. Like, and even at that point, when he's sitting there doing those things, he's still doing that completely out of fear. He's still doing that completely out of survival for his own sake. He's not doing it for anybody else. The only time that he actually ever does something that's not for himself is when he realized, actually, you know what? I'm going to rephrase that. He still does it for just himself, really. Like, except for maybe the last bit with Yuno, when he realizes where she's come from and what happened to her, then he does have a little bit of... He has a little bit of guilt, and he realizes, oh, wow, she's had a pretty hard time, too. And then he kind of does something for her. But even up to that point, everything he had done was completely selfish. I didn't really like it, to be honest with you. Plus, the show itself was really hard for us to record because we had a ton of technical difficulties while we were recording. Did you have any other part to that question?
No, that's pretty much it.
All right, cool. Thank you. Yes.
Two questions.
Okay.
Number one, what's the
could be.
So, like, I wonder, just because we've seen, and like, we'll do some theory crafting, you know, for those of us that have not read the manga, here we go. I wonder if what is in Dr. Jaeger's basement, mm-hmm. aside from the recipe for Jaeger Monster, aside from that, I'm wondering if it is a tunnel to the outside. I'm wondering if it's something that, because obviously he knew about what was happening. Like, he knows, obviously Dr. Jaeger is in on the whole timer shifter thing. And whether, like, to me, I have so many different ideas as to what it could be. But I'm wondering if, was Jaeger working with the Titan shifters that broke through the wall? Or was he working against them? And if he is working against them, did he just not know when they were going to do what they did? Like, and I know there's also a bunch of really corrupt stuff that's going on in the interior. There's all these politics and stuff and all that stuff going on, and they could be fighting against that. That could be what the whole, you know, Titan shifters are coming in for. Plus, we also know, okay, those that I've seen all the way through, who watched the last episode of Titan all the way up to the very last second end of the, okay, who did not, who has seen the whole series but did not watch up to the very last second?
Oh
my God, go back. Go back and watch. Like, and especially in on the last episode, okay, because I know at least everybody has seen the last episode. Did you look at and read the eye catch at the midpoint break?
Yeah. Yes.
Because who actually stopped and read the eye catch? Who did not? Who did not read the eye catch? Oh my God. Do you want me to just tell you what it says?
Yeah.
All right. So it's the very long. It's written as if it's from an excerpt from someone's diary, and it's a story about this guy who lived inside the second wall, but very close to the interior, and he had longed for a better life, and he had longed to be able to be up there with the nobles and the aristocrats and to live this life of luxury. And he got it in his head that he was going to dig beneath the wall and come out on the other side so nobody saw him. Well, he goes out night after night and he starts digging away, trying to get underneath the wall. And the further and further down it goes, the wall just keeps going. The wall just keeps going. Until at one point, one night, he hits the bottom and the wall goes outward. The wall is not just these three, it is completely underneath them as well and extends outward. Like this wall could potentially be going all the way underground and spreading out underneath all three lands, like all of these different territories. So, and then at the end of that very last shot that you see, do you want me to tell you what's in that very last shot?
Yeah.
Are y'all cool with me telling you what's in the last shot? Raise your hand if you're not cool with me telling you what's in the last shot.
Leave.
Not cool? Not cool? Alright, cool. That's totally fine. I will not do it again. Alright. Go back and watch it. Because just knowing that it continues to go, that the wall continues, and then seeing what they show in that very last shot is what's really making me think that perhaps these Titan Shifters are actually not necessarily after humanity itself. They're not there to punish humanity. All this collateral damage and all the people that have been dying as a result of them breaking through the walls have just been collateral. I think that they're going after the building. I think that it has to be something to do with the walls themselves.
Exactly.
And so, just go watch it again. It's so cool. So we are actually over time now. This was so much fun, guys. I really hope that you enjoyed it. If you did not get to ask any questions, please get fired.